Nobody English speaking, only one. Good. So the entire room gets lucky. I'll stick to English then, if that's not a problem. In this talk, I was asked to tell a bit about the company, and this might be interesting for you if you have some ideas of maybe starting one day your own company or making it more of a real business. I wanted to share some lessons that I've learned in the past year. I'm absolutely not an expert on setting up companies because this is my first company. So I will share the lessons that I have learned up until this point where we are at right now. So this is the short program that I put together. If you have any questions, just interrupt, and I'd like to make this as interactive as possible. Just a little bit about me. I started my career at Systron, one of the first internet providers, together with Access for All back then. Based on Hectic back then. I was 16 when I joined there, so I learned quite a lot working there. After that, I worked as an independent contractor for government, finance, and all different kind of jobs, mostly ethical hacking, project management at a certain point, consulting. And I quit consulting in 2016, started Cybersprint a bit before, and it was also to keep paying the bills that I did consulting when starting the new company. I'm a Perl fan, but actually since I started Cybersprint, I didn't really code a line of Perl because I think Perl is dead. Switched to Python because that's what the security community is actually using. I've done all the certifications, which are quite worthless if you do not want to keep paying them every year to renew. So I've let them all expire. And one of the things that I say a lot myself is that I learn through synthesis, which means that you copy by doing. You copy by looking at how other people are doing it and then applying that in your own environment. So this is Cybersprint. We are with 15 people today. There's two more starting next month. They're growing rather quick right now. One of the things that one of the pitch coaches gave me is that when you have a presentation, the audience is always ranging between, okay, there's some of it good out there that's going to start this company next week, or this company has been around for a couple of years and has big clients. That is also what I want to do in the beginning now. We started 2.5 years ago, two people. We're now at 15. We're expecting to double this year based on the current clients that we have, new clients, and also something regarding investment. And I can tell a bit more in detail if that has your interest. But before I go there, I would like to know if there's any contractors in the room, people that work within their own company already or have done it in the past. I know Mark does because he also works for me sometimes. in the past, maybe some people who have ideas of starting their own company or making more of a business out of it. I think the switch from being a contractor and just billing the hours you work to what I call a real company with people working for you, clients, responsibilities on that skill, is quite a change. It has been a change for me, at least. So. There's one last thing here. It says investment. There are several terms that I've learned in the past year, which I didn't know before that. And the first one is seed round. I raised €700,000 with an investment company. They bought a bit of the shares of my company because they believe we have a certain growth and that will represent a certain value after a couple of years. So they bought a percentage of the shares of me, gave me €700,000, which I used to grow the company quicker. I'm going to do that again this year and going to get a little bit more money. 3 to 5 million is quite a lot of money to spend. I can think of a lot of ideas on how to spend it, but also in a responsible fashion is quite hard. But this is the reason why I do that. We don't really have any competition with what we do, and I will show you what we do later on. In Europe, we don't have any direct competition. We do have a lot of indirect competition, of course, because the cybersecurity budgets are very limited still with a lot of companies, and everybody wants to take their piece of the pie. But when you look at direct competitors, there's, for example, BitSight, which is one. They give you scores on how secure you are, which is quite in a similar fashion as we do that. And ZeroFox, and if you see this, pretty small numbers from far, but it's $87 million that they have in funding from the past 3 to 5 years. It's quite a lot of money. And they're all opening offices here in Holland. So if I keep growing in the rate that we're currently doing, we are expecting to not exist anymore in 5 years, because they will have their offices here in Holland or London, Germany. And they will take over the market. They will buy the market. So luckily the Dutch are pretty nuchter. Can somebody translate it for me?
Down to earth,
thank you. So it's not very easy to buy a Dutch person's heart into actually selling a solution to them. So that is an advantage for us. So what we address for our clients is that we scan these what we call risk channels where a risk to the company can occur. For example, on the IoT spectrum, you've got devices that might appear up in Shodan. We monitor that for them. So we are actually a layer on top of all the different sources that organizations can use themselves, but which they do not have the time and knowledge for. And we do that in an automated fashion. And we do this continuously through fancy cyber dashboards. And I will mention cyber a couple more times. Just because Brenno also told me that he also hates the word cyber. We have fancy dashboards. We have 3D visuals of your environment, so you can walk through your servers, your online landscape. We're also making a VR module now, and that's very easy for selling, actually, what you do, because you don't sell to technical people. They didn't use this. But it's not very intuitive to use. Well, it is intuitive and fun to walk through it, but it's not helping you in doing your job. But management, the ones buying it, they use these kinds of screens to show to their colleagues how cool the solutions are. They really have to address that part of your solution. One sidestep is there was a press release yesterday from a innovation grant of €200,000 that we got from the Ministry of Justice and Peace, which is about SBIR. Probably have heard it before, but it's an innovation battle where you can send in your ideas. I think there were 15 winners this year, KPN, Trax Inspector, some other big names, and us. And what we're going to do is we're going to make cool open source software with that. You might know Cuckoo Sandbox, open source malware analytics engine. Julian Bremer is closely working with us, and he's also doing a large part of this project, where we will be creating a honeypotting environment, more of a framework, where you can automatically import firmware from a vendor website, boot it in a controlled environment, and then do more analysis on that, behavioral analysis on what it actually is doing. If you connect it to the internet and people start doing things with your device. You can also do other interesting things like fuzzing attacks on that and doing it on a mass scale. So downloading all the versions of the Fritzbox, for example, attaching a fuzzer to the web interface, and then trying to find new bugs. So this will be open source. It will take 1.5 years for this project to finish. But it's cool to keep an eye on. This is actually what it looks like in the current first proof of concept that we made as a proof that we think this is feasible. What you see here is a debugger attached to a virtual machine that is running the Fritzbox firmware, actually. And Fritzbox is relatively easy when you look at architectures because 80% of the landscape uses the same architecture. But it's I think it's interesting to see that this is possible. I'm now trying to also look at hardware from Siemens, from NXP, other big vendors that currently all have their own labs doing all the work themselves, reinventing the wheel themselves in their own labs, and trying to bridge that together and see if we can get our hands on some cool Siemens firmware. One of the things I think is important when you have an idea of starting your own company is trying to find a niche where you do not have much competition. Because if you're going to, for example, start a solution for, say, network monitoring, intrusion detection, there's a lot of solutions already that do that. So try to find a niche, and that's what we did. There's some random vendors here. If you're missing some vendors, let me know, and I will add them. On the internal side of organizations, there are a lot of solutions already that if you plug them into your network, they will tell you which devices you have connected to the network. And it was not really a turnkey solution on the outside. So what clients do with our solution is they tell us what their brands are, and we will automatically map out their entire attack surface. So we combine a lot of open source intelligence. We use most of the tools like ReconNG, Sublister, and all the various reconnaissance tooling available. And if you have that, you can connect it to other tools like Nessus, Guardian 360, and other cool solutions. And just because you are here in this part, clients that are starting with cybersecurity, they're thinking, okay, maybe we should do something because everybody's mentioning GDPR, AVG, all the other cool buzzwords. They will ask us first because you are in the first part of the chain in the security they usually address. So it's really finding the niche that's important in doing that. So what I did is, and this is not a guarantee for success, it's just how it worked out for me. Find a niche, talk about it a lot, talk about it with other people, people that might potentially be your buyers. What I did is I went on what they call a trade mission. It's open for everybody. It's not really commonly known, but if you go to the rvo.nl website, you can sign up for a trade mission. There's one going to RSA in April. So maybe within the company that you work for, you can also apply for it. And what that means is that you will travel together with other Dutch officials from the government, also from large companies. I did it with a lot of CISOs from banks. And I spoke to them about my ideas, and they gave me feedback on what would work, what wouldn't work. And by applying that feedback, I made something, and I sold it to friends. And that was, for me, it was proof that there is actually some bit of a market. If you do that, you can, and you are successful with that, you try to find your launching customers. And what I did, I gained just enough money with the launching customers that I could quit my consulting and could focus full time on this. And that was, for me, was a turning point in going from doing it on the side, which is basically consisted of doing both things full time. And you can't do two things full time for quite too long. What I did, and that's really a point of standing at crossroads, you can decide to grow organically, like getting a new customer, getting not a new customer, hire somebody else for development, for example, so you can get more customers. And it's continuously some kind of race that you need to keep growing. I really wanted to grow a bit faster. So what I did is I raised the money so I could hire a lot more developers. I had a lot more cost than I had on income, but it allowed me to get more features in there quickly and get more customers to the platform. So it's a gamble, but it worked out for me. And I will get to the other points a bit later. Do you have any questions so far? Any things that you think should be addressed? This is somebody said this to me at, I think it was the day before I actually started. And most startups fail because they never start. I had a lot of ideas. I've, for the past 10 years, been thinking about doing this, doing that, but actually never went through with it. And then somebody said this to me, and it was quite the game changer for me, just starting immediately. One of the lessons I learned, which was quite important for me, is making a choice. You're either doing consulting or you're providing a product or services. If you're going to mix them, you'll get a lot of distraction from, in my case, from consulting. So we did a big consulting gig in 2016, and it wasn't good because it distracted you to go a lot of hours go into consulting with that customer, which could also have been going into your product development. So focus is really important. If you choose not to do consulting, don't do it, because we are with 15 people now. I can always outplace these people if I want to add all my customers. So there's a huge demand for that. So you need to find partners who are doing that, who have their core focus on consulting, for example. Finding proper partners is important because in my case, Maarten, which was the second in the row of hires, Maarten is my only non-technical hire, but he's a very experienced manager and he does everything which is non-technical, like legal, finance, HR. All the important things that also need to be addressed, which I find rather boring, but you need to have them. Otherwise, you'll not be able to grow. The time for getting money is not when you cannot pay the bills anymore. So you need to plan. You need to either decide we're going to go a different route or we're going to raise money at a certain time. This is also a planning thing. When are you going to raise the money? This is a quote that somebody gave me when I was thinking of raising money, and it's really about the timing at that point. So for us right now, it's way too early to start raising money because we're planning to do it at the end of the year, which makes the conversations with potential investors really easy. There's a lot of money in cybersecurity right now, and there's not many startups with the actual heartbeat in there. So I think there's a lot of opportunity if you have a good idea. This picture made the front page of nu.nl, and I have no idea why, because there's not much news value in here, but it does work. Everybody remembers this. When they Google me, they find this. It's all about status and aligning with people with status. The public relations are one, for me, it was the highest cost last year. We spent around, I think, 400K on PR alone, and it will take at least a year before you can, how do you say that? Reap the benefits, thank you.
See the effect.
Yeah. And we are first noticing now the impact of the PR spendings of last year, which is really good for sales as well, because what now happens is when we are having a sales meeting, people know us already from the news or from the specific news outlets they have. So you also need to think when there's a news item, how do I want to be involved in that? I do get calls a lot. Do you want to respond to a news item? And what we chose is that we only respond to things that we have a direct relation with. Because I think we all know it's rather easy to get a talking point on television or on radio. but it's, I do have a picture of Rian later on, sorry. but you have to choose wisely. Do you want to be, in my opinion, ambulance chaser, following all the news items and just repeating the same talking point? Or do you actually have something to share which is new or attached to the news? And building a brand is really important because people really want to feel the business card. They want to see nice paper with a logo on there, because if you do not have that, you're not a real company. That's my experience. I have a case with a client where we were a bit not much focused on the brand yet. I put in a quote for the service and they were like, okay, this I could understand this high amount from a company like Fox IT, but not from you. You're still a small startup. So you need to work on making yourself look bigger than you actually are. So that's what all about building a brand is all about. And that's also where the PR kicks in. Teaming up is important. We're a small country. So you need to try to find the relevant players in a country and team up with them, go into the battle together. And networking, when I referred to the trade mission earlier, which was to Atlanta and Washington, I think it was at Mark Rutte. He also made the news when he was visiting Coca-Cola, while we had a lot of issues with some political situation in Holland. He was drinking Coke, was the headline. But I came back from that trade mission with around 300 business cards of contacts I just met there. So you need to talk a lot, and that's quite a challenge if that's not really into your DNA. When you actually have customers, you need to service them, and you need to make it a pleasant experience for them. So you need to overachieve, and you will lose money on your first customers, because you will put way too much time in those customers. But that is because they will tell you what is wrong, what needs to be changed. And when you reach that point that they're satisfied, they get to renew the contract. At that point, it's relatively easy to upsell to existing customers than finding new customers. That's my personal experience. Not sure if this works, probably does. So I'm a fan of Aikido. What I learned with Aikido is that you need to constantly repeat the same boring things over and over again, because you will end up in an unexpected situation where you need to apply it immediately. So I think this is the best example of an unexpected situation. You encounter someone with a sword, what do? And this is the best technique out there in Aikido. You can choose between getting your head split or walking out and going further. And that's something you also need to keep in mind when you're doing business. Your ego needs to be put aside at times, if you can do that. This is the plate I bought for my kids. I've got three kids, and one of them, age two, is not really a good eater. So we made it a game. There's a piece of chocolate here. I have to put duct tape over it now, otherwise he'll eat it first. but if I gamify it in this way, she will eat. She will eat all the things and then end up with a chocolate at the last part, and I'm happy and she's happy. You can do that within your company or with your customers in a lot of ways as well. But you also need to take care in what kind of incentives you create. And this is a quote, and I think it shows my age a bit, from one of Terry Pratchett's books. I cannot recall which one. But they paid the firemen by the amount of fires they put out. They stopped doing that on Charcoal Tuesday. Yeah, regarding hiring, the Dutch system of hiring people gives employees a lot of protections, but that's a given, that you know that up front when you start with someone. So you need to make sure that you're hiring the right person. And right person doesn't mean it could also be a bad person, but it could be a misfit, like this person will fit in another company, but not in your team maybe. Or you actually might require different skills. And when you're a small company, one bad hire can kill your company. Why I think hackers like you should be the best CEOs out there is that because you communicate, you can communicate in code. If somebody asks me about a certain feature, I can just commit the feature to Git and I can make myself perfectly clear because it either fails the test or not. This also helps within the company. There are some also benefits when you're doing sales. I do the most sales myself within the company because I think I know quite a lot of things regarding security. Especially when you're doing sales meetings, you sometimes encounter people that are better than you, but you need to be able to acknowledge that, of course. But if you always tell the truth regarding your own solution, regarding what you hear in the world, then it's a pretty easy job selling things. And within cybersecurity or InfoSec, I think sales is the hardest job because in most other industries, with sales, you do not need much knowledge about what you're actually selling. And cybersecurity is quite a different ballpark.
How do you scale beyond yourself, so to speak?
Yeah, that's a very good good question. Thank you. My path for that is one, hire somebody different for sales. We're having a change there. 1st of March, I will get the director of one of the companies which was in the earlier picture from Netskope. He has the network, he has the experience within cybersecurity. So I think that will be a first fix. And the other one, we're currently servicing enterprises mostly. ING is one of our reference customers, for example. So these customers require a lot of direct contact. And I will not send somebody else there but me. That's one of the things. The other one is that we're downscaling in the market regarding automation, self-service setups. So it will be more of account management that people do than actually sales. So I hope that answers your question. Also, one thing that which is not in the slide regarding partners, there's a lot of companies that resell security services in Holland, but not going to run for you because they get offers from a lot of other companies that also have way cooler ideas, they think, but they're not going to run for you. You need to actually come in there with a first sale, and then they might actually consider including you in their portfolio of security solutions. And I learned that by mistakes as well. I've been talking with some very large cybersecurity companies, and they really loved this idea. They brought me to some of their customers, but they didn't follow up. So I put my energy on that, which was a mistake. So I switched to direct sales again back then.
Was that cybersecurity company Fox IT?
No, it was not Fox IT. No. Regarding pitfalls, what I caught myself saying, or actually Cynthia, my security officer and product owner for the platform, she mentioned it. I always say about a feature, this will take 5 minutes. but we have, this could be our backlog in Jira. We have a lot of 5 minute features in our backlog. So estimating things gets a bit different sometimes. It does require social skills, which I didn't really possess before starting my own business like 15 years ago. So you need to learn on that, get coached, get training, but also just do it. What I find myself also doing is going to deep hack mode, continue features, find more bugs, add more new features, add performance tweaks, and not spend time on the things that also need to be done, like something regarding stakeholders, the investments, maybe some things that you do not want to find time for. And that's the challenge when you're technical and also in charge. That's the same slide, sorry. I've heard this has been shown a couple of times before. I think this will be my last slide, sorry, yeah. What I also learned is that when I was an independent contractor, I did not have any attack surface myself. My company was white label, I didn't have a website, I have an email address, but that's all. Nowadays, I have a company with an online footprint, we have a portal, we have a website, which is quite scary if you're a security specialist yourself, that you are actually now becoming a target yourself. I was just sitting in a room downstairs and I saw some enthusiast people next to me already doing subdomain listing on her domain. And we do get a lot of responsible disclosure ourselves, but you need to be ready for that and have processes in place for that. This was my last slide, I think. Any questions so far or at the end?
Questions? None? Then I'll take the other mic.
Okay, then I want to thank you for your interesting talk about how you started your business and how you grew your business. What I learned from your presentation was that it's easier to upsell to existing customers. So I hope I can get you into sponsoring next year's event. I want to thank Peter for his talk.
Thank you. That's good, right? Thank you.